Conquest of Mars. But wouldn't it have been better to descend to Phobos first? The planet Mars is already mysterious, always at the center of convoluted historical and observational events and conjectures bordering on science fiction. Such a planet, could it have normal moons with a normal history? No, obviously not. And in fact, the red planet is found with the smallest, strange, and talked about moons of the solar system. Talked about even before their discovery, since their existence and their almost exact distance from Mars was already predicted by the Irish writer Johnatan Swift in 1726. That is 150 years before their actual discovery, which occurred in 1877, thanks to the observational tenacity of the American astronomer Asaph Hall. Mysterious moons, because even today it is not possible to understand where they came from, since they look like two small asteroids, but they follow perfectly regular orbits, as they were big moons like Ganymede or Titan. And now, thanks to their inevitable position, they are also involved in the plans for the conquest and exploration of Mars. In the immediate future, there are in fact plans to visit them and bring home some soil to examine, and in the near future, there is talk of using them as space stations, permanently facing the mysteries of the red planet. But before we get into the details, it will help to know all the features of these two fantastic mini worlds. What do you say? Shall we begin? Dimensions. Contrary to our moon, the Martian satellites are small and their size does not exceed tens of kilometers. Impossible to speak of diameter because both have a very irregular shape, so you need three values to define the proportions. Phobos measures 27 by 22 by 19 kilometers, and its surface is literally pockmarked by impact craters, the largest of which has a diameter of 10 kilometers, more than a third of the entire satellite. It was given the name Stickney in honor of Hall's young wife, who encouraged her husband to continue the research despite the first disappointing results. The event that formed Stickney must have been of such violence as to endanger the very existence of Phobos, and a series of long steps, which are like giant nails, depart from the crater, is there to witness the brutality of the impact. They were first observed in the 1970s by the Mariner and Viking missions, and their origin has been the subject of much debate. Some have suggested that violent impacts suffered by Mars have poured on the small moon a shower of debris capable of scratching the surface, those who think that the Martian gravity has created structural cracks on the satellite, and those who finally believe that there is some kind of connection with the impact that generated Stickney. And apparently, a recent simulation has given reason to the third hypothesis, showing that following the devastating impact that has formed Stickney, the tons of rock raised, accomplices the reduced gravity and the small size of Phobos, have continued to roll, making the full circle of the moon, returning in some cases to the starting point. A continuous bouncing on the surface has left those incredible scars that make Phobos an immediately recognizable object. Deimos is also an approximately triaxial object. Its dimensions are 15 by 12 by 11 kilometers, and its surface appears much smoother, although the density of craters is similar to that of the surface of Phobos and the lunar plateaus. This is due to the presence of a thick layer of regolith that almost completely fills some craters. It is also believed that the formation of a concavity of about 10 kilometers in diameter, present in the southern hemisphere, would be responsible for the degradation of the surface. The seismic energy produced by the impact, in fact, would have propagated through the entire object in the form of waves, causing the collapse of smaller structures. Mass and density. Due to their very small mass, Phobos and Deimos obviously have a very weak gravity, less than 1/1000th of the Earth's gravity. Just think that a 70-kilogram person would weigh on Phobos just 40 grams, and to get away from the surface and get lost in space would be enough to reach an escape velocity of just 41 kilometers per hour. The density of the two satellites is quite low, 1.9 grams per cubic centimeter for Phobos and 1.5 grams for Deimos, but in line with that of most asteroids of carbonaceous type. For comparison, the Moon has a density of 3.3, Earth 5.5, and Mars 4.4. With such a density, it is almost certain that the two moons cannot have a completely solid structure. Their interior could be made of a set of very fine particles aggregated to large rocky blocks, with large gaps in their interstice. Orbit. Strangely enough, the two moons travel in almost circular orbits, only slightly inclined to the equatorial plane of Mars. Orbits that, as we will see later, would expect from moons of greater mass, and not from two wandering asteroids captured by chance by the gravitational field of Mars. Phobos orbits at a distance of 9,380 kilometers, while Deimos is a little further away, 23,460 kilometers from the center of the planet. Phobos makes a complete revolution in 7 hours and 39 minutes, which means that every Martian day, just over 24 hours, completes more than 3 revolutions of the planet. But the most unusual thing is that because of its period of revolution, much lower than the rotation period of Mars, this small moon appears to move in the sky with retrograde motion. Seen, therefore, from the surface of Mars, Phobos appears as an object that, rising in the west, crosses the sky very quickly, setting in the east after only 3 hours and 10 minutes from its rising. Deimos, on the contrary, is much slower. It normally rises in the east and sets in the west, completing a complete revolution in 30 hours and 18 minutes. The rotation of the two moons is synchronous. Both always show the same face to Mars, with the major axis of their figure pointing to the planet, exactly as the moon always shows the same face to the Earth. In addition, being very close to the planet, Phobos and Deimos are not visible from all Martian regions. The polar regions are excluded. To see Phobos, an observer must be in locations between 69 degrees north and 69 degrees south latitude, and between 82 degrees north and 82 degrees south to see Deimos. Hang on a sec, guys, before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell. You will help us to make products of even higher quality. Origin and formation. The origin of the moons of Mars have always puzzled astronomers. Their irregular shape and their tiny size have always suggested that they were two asteroids captured by the planet. But their orbital parameters, orbits almost perfectly circular on the equatorial plane of Mars, and a rotation synchronous with that of the planet, have led scientists to believe more likely that they had originated from the impact of Mars with a celestial body of 1,000 kilometers in diameter. However, a problem remains. Why did that impact end with the formation of two small moons and not a single large moon like ours or a ring of orbiting debris? Recent computer simulations have shown that the innermost part of the ring of debris initially formed one or more large moons, but under the action of tidal forces caused by the nearby intense gravitational field of Mars, would then disintegrate. Their remains would have finally fallen on the planet. The same fate would have happened to the smaller satellites and will happen in the future to Phobos, whose orbit, already dangerously close to the point of disintegration, narrows every year by about 2 centimeters. Nothing is forever, and in fact, whatever their origin, we know anyway that the two satellites will not have a long life. Almost at the limit of the synchronous orbit, Deimos is in fact moving away very slowly from the surface of the red planet, a calm and quick end in stark contrast to the more dramatic one that awaits Phobos. The largest of the Martian moons is in fact destined to fall on Mars. Slowly but surely, the tidal forces are tightening on the unfortunate satellite, which in a period between 20 and 40 million years will end up exceeding the so-called Roche limit, equal for Mars to about 5,470 kilometers away from the surface. Reach this point of no return, the difference between the tidal forces that are exerted on the face closer to the planet and the farthest will exceed its internal cohesion, and the satellite will explode into 1,000 pieces. Although some large fragments will fall on Mars as many meteorites, most of the debris will probably contribute to the formation of a ring around the planet. Space exploration. Long before their disappearance, the two small moons will, however, have plenty of time to give us a hand in the exploration of Mars. And not in 1,000 years. Already for 2024, in fact, is the scheduled start of the Japanese mission Martian Moons Exploration, or MMX, responsible for bringing back to Earth a sample of the material that covers the surface of Phobos. MMX will enter Mars's orbit a year after launch. It will gradually get closer to Phobos, entering what mission planners call a quasi-orbit. While it may look like MMX is orbiting Phobos, it is actually just orbiting Mars in a way that lets it circle Phobos at the same time. This will be no easy challenge, since Phobos is deep inside Mars's gravity well and just 6,000 kilometers above the surface. MMX will spend a year studying Phobos with its remote science instruments, while searching for a safe and scientifically interesting place to land. A wide-angle camera and laser mapping system will map the moon in 3D, while a narrow-angle camera provides a closer look at specific areas. These spectrometers will determine the mineral and elemental makeup of Phobos' surface. A dust sensor will also look for orbiting particles knocked off Mars and Phobos by meteor impacts. The spacecraft also includes a pair of ultra-high-resolution video cameras that will provide stunning views of Mars and its moons. Some images will be transmitted to Earth during the mission, with the rest stored in the sample return capsule for later playback. As MMX descends to Phobos for landing, it will deploy a small German and French-built rover based on the mascot, which Hayabusa 2 dropped to tumble around asteroid Raigu. The rover will travel around Phobos for at least 100 days analyzing the surface. We don't know exactly what Phobos' surface is like. Is it rocky or fluffy or sandy? MMX is prepared for a variety of possibilities with two robotic arm-mounted drills that can bore 10 centimeters beneath the surface. Once MMX collects its samples, it will lift off from Phobos and begin spiraling out of the Martian orbit, passing Deimos several times on its way out to analyze and map the smaller moon. MMX will leave Mars in 2028 and return to Earth in 2029. The spacecraft will jettison a small capsule containing the samples, which will plummet through Earth's atmosphere and use a parachute to land safely for collection. Future space stations? If all goes well, the results of the MMX mission will be decisive for the choice that awaits us in the near future. That is, whether or not to use the two satellites as permanent bases for remote exploration of the Red Planet. Phobos presents potential advantages over Moon and Mars as a human-operated outpost, at least in the early stages of real-time Mars exploration and future development. What is most important, Phobos offers an excellent position versus Mars, from which to conduct the foregoing studies and many kinds of mission operations. Reaching Phobos does not require the costly development of a major propulsive or aerobraking lander, nor does it require the delivery of that lander to lunar or Mars orbit. Phobos affords a practicable waypoint at which to locate an astrobiology laboratory that can safely conduct the examination of Mars samples with reduced danger of back contamination to the Earth. The topography of Phobos, its orbit close to the Martian surface, and rotation with one side always facing Mars provides advantages for radiation shielding. As a trade-off for not needing a big, expensive lander, the near microgravity of Phobos will demand solutions and technologies to attach or adhere all elements of the base to Phobos' surface. The Phobos mission will entail exposing its human crew to space radiation outside the friendly confines of the Earth's magnetic field, and unmitigated by any significant atmosphere. One potential mitigation might derive from the shielding afforded by Stickney Crater, the planet Mars overhead, approximately 25% of the visible hemisphere above a point on Phobos' surface, and the mass of Phobos itself. The most important thing about having an outpost so close to Mars, however, would be that from Phobos we could control in real time the movement of the Martian rovers, something that at the moment is prevented by the distance Mars-Earth, which leads to a delay in communication of up to 40 minutes between the return of the signal. A decade ago, it was even thought that even the human descent on Mars would be much easier starting from a base on Phobos, rather than with a direct trip from Earth. But now the games are done, and we will try the way of direct landing. But there is a strong bet on the fact that soon after we will set foot on the Martian moons, which from that moment will become our window constantly open on the Red Planet. And in this regard, we cannot fail to quote at this point a passage of Carl Sagan, taken from his famous book, Cosmic Connection, that does not cease to make us dream. Sooner or later, it is only a matter of decades. On the surface of Phobos, there will be instruments, and then men who will observe with terror and wonder the immense red planet filling the sky from the horizon to the zenith.